Welcome to A Look Ahead. We're delighted that you've decided to join us. You probably know by now that we study the Sabbath School lessons as prepared by the Seventh-day Adventist Church. And this particular series is on the book of James. It's the series being studied for the months of October, November, and December of 2014. And this is lesson number 12 in that series for December 20 of 2014. This particular lesson is entitled Prayer, Healing, and Restoration. And we hope that you have your Bible handy in your hand and ready to go to work as we look through a variety of verses here in addition to the book of James. We'd also like to ask the Holy Spirit to guide as we speak and think together. Our kind and wonderful Father, we ask that your Holy Spirit, who is always with us, will give special guidance as we discuss together the meanings and the importance of these verses in our daily lives. May we begin to understand more fully what it means to be restored to health, to spiritual health, and to mental health, and to physical health, is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Prayer, healing, ultimate restoration. When is that going to happen? Do we think that God would be happy to have it happen right now? Wouldn't God love to have every one of his children perfectly healthy?
That's how he created us.
Yeah. And everybody who enters heaven will be perfectly healthy, right? So I think we can comfortably say God wants us all to be healthy, right?
Yeah.
Well, so what's the problem?
Well, we're born unhealthy.
Why?
Well, that's a big question. I've raised that question before. It's something happened several thousand years ago, and we humans are kind of born unhealthy when we're born.
Okay, but now let's be clear. Is it just because of something that happened several thousand years ago, or is it because of things that continue to happen every day?
Yeah, it's both.
Well, things continue to happen every day because of what happened several thousand years ago. Or 2,000 years ago.
But I don't think it's fair for us to blame Eve for all of our problems. Mm-mm. I think I can generate enough problems of my own.
Our own sinful nature.
Yeah. Well, this particular passage focuses on two important characters in the Bible, Elijah and John the Baptist. When you think of Elijah and John the Baptist, what sort of pops into your mind?
Dynamic.
Translated, without seeing death.
Yeah, John was. I mean, Elijah was. John wasn't.
No, he'd suffered.
He's the other end of the spectrum.
Yeah.
He died for getting his head cut off for doing the right thing.
Yeah. Could we be Elijahs or Johns in our day?
Yes.
Do you think Elijah's day was more godless and more wicked than our day?
I don't think so. I think we've matched them pretty well.
Think so?
I think there are similarities. It's from what we know about populations of the world, I think it's worse now. But they sure had their spectrum to pick from in his day.
Elijah wasn't the only good person in his day.
No.
And I think those good people were doing what they were supposed to be doing, what they were called to do. Just like, I guess, Elijah was doing what he was called to do. So I'm not sure we all should feel guilty if we're not like Elijah.
Well, we're going to learn some very interesting things about Elijah that I learned for the first time in studying this lesson. And I've read a lot of stuff about Elijah in the past. So hang on. I think we're going to find out some stuff that maybe will surprise you. Before we go there, I want you to turn to the very last two verses in what we call the Old Testament. Malachi 4, verses 5 and 6. But before the great and terrible day of the Lord comes, I will send you the prophet Elijah. He will bring fathers and children together again, otherwise I would have to come and destroy your country. What does that mean?
I was curious about fathers, if you could go back to that.
Yeah.
Fathers and children. Does he mean God and us as children? Or does he mean your biological father to the children?
I think the answer is yes.
So either one?
Both.
Okay.
Yeah. Absolutely. Well, here's what Ellen White says about the experience of John in particular. John was an example. And Jesus himself said, you know, he's like Elijah. John separated himself from friends and from the luxuries of life. Think about that for a moment. The simplicity of his dress, a garment woven of camel's hair, was a standing rebuke to the extravagance and display of the Jewish priests and of the people generally. I don't think that could possibly apply to us today, right? His diet, purely vegetable, of locusts and wild honey, was a rebuke to the indulgence of appetite and the gluttony that everywhere prevailed. I wonder if that could apply to us. The great subject of reform is to be agitated, and the public mind is to be stirred. Temperance in all things is to be connected with the message to turn the people of God from their idolatry, their gluttony, and their extravagance in dress and other things. Wow. The self-denial, humility, and temperance required of the righteous, whom God especially leads and blesses, is to be presented to the people in contrast to the extravagant, health-destroying habits of those who live in this degenerate age. God has shown that health reform is as closely connected with the third angel's message as the hand is with the body. Volume 3 of Testimonies, pages 62, paragraph 1 and 2, and a bunch more other places. As John the Baptist called their attention to the Ten Commandments, so we are to give with no uncertain sound the message, and I quote, "Fear God and give glory to Him, for the hour of His judgment is come." Where does that come from? Revelation 14:6, right? The first angel's message. With the earnestness that characterized Elijah the prophet and John the Baptist, we are to strive to prepare the way for Christ's second advent. Gary, how do we do that? Southern Watchman, March 21, 1905.
We prepare for the second coming. That's a very good question.
Well,
that's
why I asked it. Just read it there with the
of earnestness that characterized Elijah and John.
but the message was there.
What is difficult today is I believe Satan has rounded society with laws that are called politically correct. Mm-hmm. And John the Baptist and Elijah would both be not politically correct, but there weren't as many laws around them. So in a way, it might be harder for us, because the laws are in place to shut the mouths of anybody who dare speak not what our humanistic society wants to. I mean, stealthily, these laws have been enacted.
What would people be doing if they were mimicking John the Baptist today?
Well, what did he do?
Well, he didn't have cars.
No.
He didn't have PA systems.
We would be without cars, without pieces. Okay.
But what would it be?
Let's not talk about the things he didn't do or things he didn't have. What did he do?
Okay, he went out into the desert, into the wilderness. Mm-hmm. So if you and I go out in the wilderness and start yelling, will people start coming?
He was close to the river, and people came there all the time for water and so forth.
Transfer, you know, there was a
okay, maybe we can stand by a highway somewhere and have a big flag and a big tent or something. Do you think
if we were preaching God's message faithfully and well, standing by a highway, do you think God would bring people to hear us?
Well, I'd like to see, do you have an example of that happening today?
No, I wish I did.
It is.
Nobody's doing it.
It is happening today. Mm-hmm. On the TV, LLBN, 3ABN, Hope Channel, and these others are meeting people standing on maybe an empty station on satellite that no one sees but maybe one or two people or maybe a million people. And saying like John the Baptist, I think it is happening in a modern way.
I don't know if John the Baptist was preaching to the choir, though.
These TV stations are not preaching to the choir.
You don't think so?
Well, they're preaching to the choir, but they're preaching to anybody else who's willing to listen as well.
Absolutely. They're on public stations.
What choir was John the Baptist preaching to?
The scribes and Pharisees.
That's his choir? I don't think so. Those are all different.
The soldiers? Those are the ones that are specifically mentioned.
He was preaching to all the Jews.
You're not giving my point here. That
I am.
All the church members.
The whole nation.
To the choir, that means you're already preaching to people that already believes it, but they want to hear it again. When John the Baptist was out there, he was preaching new stuff. It was coming all over the place. People were talking about it, causing all kinds of.
Don't you think if you got up and really preached the message of Scripture, it would be totally new to 99% of the people in America today?
Yeah.
Well, I don't know. I don't know.
I'd be willing to put money on it.
Well, a lot of the stuff that we preach is, it's just a lot of.
No. Me and my nephew switched a station. We're not Adventists and came to learn all that through the TV. So,
okay, I give that to you. That you know, it does happen.
But there's millions more like me.
I'm trying to think about the proportions. You know, with what John the Baptist was doing, the things he was shaking up. He was even shaking up Herod. In fact, he got killed because of it.
What would happen if a group of Seventh-day Adventists were willing to say, "Okay, I'm willing to give a couple hours every Sunday morning to go to a Sunday church around in my area, and go to their Bible study class and raise some questions."
Believe me, you'd have a good time. And you would be miles ahead of anybody there, probably. Majority of them.
It's a very interesting experience.
It sounds interesting. Has anybody done it here?
Yeah, that's
you.
I went once.
I did it a couple
once?
Of times.
Once? Is that enough?
Well, I went out thinking about it. I'm seriously thinking about it because I went to a group not too far from here that they were just starting up at something new, and so I wasn't sure whether I should continue.
I've done it in the past as well, with Baptists, Mormons, even Muslim to a certain extent.
Most of them really do not want to hear, you know, but their awareness is raised.
Yeah, it's
their awareness is raised.
Anyway,
Well, but when you ask questions about them, you're certainly going to use biblical illustrations and stories from the Old Testament. What when Elijah did this? So how does that fit here, and so forth? Most of those people don't even know who Elijah. Most of these people don't know who Elijah is or where he fits into the Bible. They don't know if he came before Isaac or Moses or Malachi or anybody else.
Most of these people, what do you mean?
I'm talking about
typical Americans.
Typical American Christians.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I thought you were talking about people that are in the churches.
No. Well, you mean Adventist churches.
You know, the Adventists are so used to asking questions and searching and debating. Also, I'm in a class of about 100 people. The teacher talks. Not a question. Not a question. The people don't ask a question, and he doesn't allow a question.
Group.
Non-Adventist. Mm-hmm. It's mind-blowing. And they, like 100 people, substantial people, wealthy people, and then they just leave. Not a question.
Well, I've seen some Adventist Sabbath schools like that, too.
I think you have to adjust your method to where you are at the time.
Sure.
You have to be adaptable. Mm-hmm. And I think John was. He was doing it in the area where he could. When you think about it, you don't hear much about this. He had a similar upbringing to Christ.
Mm-hmm.
They were related. His parents knew he was coming. He must have been exposed to the synagogue or somewhere.
His father was a priest.
Exactly. And he was out there doing his thing, and yes, he ultimately paid the price. But
well, the Adventist Church, we're talking about ways to witness. The Adventist Church, almost from its beginning, has been deeply involved in health. Is that a way to witness?
Yeah.
We operate hundreds of clinics. I've worked with 20 or 30 of them at a time when I used to be in Africa. We have hundreds of hospitals. Are we using those outreach methods effectively? Think about all the schools we operate. Well, let's look at an example from the story of Jesus. Look at Mark 2, verses 1 through 12. A few days later, Jesus went back to Capernaum. Why was he going back to Capernaum?
Peter's house.
Okay. Capernaum was his designated home spot during his ministry. He was going home to Peter's house, I might add, and as you already pointed out, and the news spread that he was at home. So many people came together that there was no room left, not even out in front of the door. Jesus was preaching the message to them when four men arrived carrying a paralyzed man to Jesus. Because of the crowd, however, they could not get the man to him. So they made a hole in the roof right above the place where Jesus was. When they had made an opening, they let the man down lying on his mat. Seeing how much faith they had, Jesus said to the paralyzed man, "My son, your sins are forgiven." Some teachers of the law who were sitting there thought to themselves, "How does he dare to talk like this? This is blasphemy. God is the only one who can forgive sins." Now, what was their belief about sickness in those days so that we understand what's going on here?
God's not smiling on you.
Yeah.
If you are sick, it's because you've done something wrong and God is cursing you. At once, Jesus, going back to the Bible now, Mark 2, verse 8, at once Jesus knew what they were thinking, so he said to them, "Why do you think such things? Is it easier to say to this paralyzed man, 'Your sins are forgiven'" — that would be the cause of his illness, right? — "or to say, 'Get up, pick up your mat, and walk'? I will prove to you then that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins." So he said to the paralyzed man, "I tell you, get up, pick up your mat, and go home." While they all watched, the man got up, picked up his mat, and hurried away. They were all completely amazed and praised God, saying, "We have never seen anything like this."
Was he not validating then with that approach and with the words that he used and the comparison he used, that wasn't he not validating then that that your sins that you've committed are what's causing your ailments here? And so, well, he forgives the sins, and so
I would
and
really,
don't we consider that a false concept? That
I would really, really encourage anybody who has a few minutes to read Desire of Ages, page 267 to 271, and Ministry of Healing, page 73 to 79. It won't take you very long. Those are the two places where Ellen White really deals with this story in depth. She says several things. One, she says it was Peter's house. She says that this man was looking for, most of all, forgiveness of his sins, because it was his sins that had led to this particular disease. We don't know what the disease was, but it was some disease that was a result of his own sin.
Yes. So in this case, the preconception of the religious leaders
was
that
correct.
If you're sick, then you're in this case, it was...
Furthermore, he had gone to those very priests and said, "You're the one designated by the Old Testament to heal people. Can you help me?" And they said, "Get out of here. Leave us alone. You are being cursed by God. There's nothing we can do for you."
The man obviously had some insight, and he'd made up his mind there was a better way to go, which I think is why Christ did...
When he heard about Jesus, he said to his friends, "I believe this guy can heal me." Yeah. And his friend said, "We're on our way." They picked him up and they carried him. And he was next to death's door when they arrived there. Okay? They let him down through the roof, and of course he goes home completely healed, and his friends are totally amazed, of course. And you know, what's going on here? Well,
did this man recognize truth when he saw it? And
he was ready to die for Jesus, Ellen White says.
And when people see us, they should recognize the truth has a certain ring about it, Ellen White says.
Wouldn't that
they
be
should,
nice?
They should recognize that we are speaking the truth, mm-hmm. and it's our responsibility to learn the truth so that we have that certain mm-hmm. melody
Well, now I want you to stop for a moment and ask yourself, suppose you had been one of the Pharisees or scribes there on that day.
What would you do? Well, you would either change your mind or you would get madder, one or the other.
Mm-hmm. And well, that's what they
and
did.
Probably got mad.
You know, so. When God with Pharaoh in Egypt, he says he hardened Pharaoh's heart. He applied pressure in situations, so Pharaoh was either going to change his mind, go with God, or go against God. And so God is applying pressure to see, okay, what camp are you in?
Well, think about the case of Jesus here. Everybody in that audience believed that this man's disease was a direct result of his sin. Okay? They believed that only God could forgive sins. They're all listening, and Jesus says, I forgive you your sins. They all believe, basically, that that was heresy. Oh,
blasphemy.
Blasphemy, not just heresy, blasphemy. And now Jesus says, okay, do you want to know if I can forgive sins? Take up your bed and walk out. And this was an airtight case as far as they were concerned. If you believe as they believe, I mean, Jesus has just proven that he's God by their thinking. We would say, well, maybe not quite to that point. But, I mean, you have to have God to do that kind of. I mean, you get somebody who's on death's door and he jumps up and walks out. I mean, we would be inclined to think that's God's activity.
It's been said, if somebody, if we have a live resurrection on live TV or if somebody arises from the dead, the whole world's going to follow after him. But it didn't have any salutary effect upon the religious leaders of Jesus' day. All it did was harden their heart.
But I think in our day it could.
There would be some, of course.
Well, what I'm getting at is it's an avenue the devil's going to take. We've talked about this before, and people are receptive to the supernatural.
Yeah.
Be it good
or
bad.
As long as it's the right people.
Exactly.
The right people that they're going to follow. But if it's somebody they don't like, well then, and they heal somebody, well then they just get more angry.
Let's ask a question now. Does healing, the necessary healing, involve not just the physical, but also the mental and the spiritual?
Absolutely.
Yes. The whole thing.
How well are we doing at healing the spiritual?
What's your question here? Is that there's no such thing as pure physical healing?
No. I'm saying we have tended to focus only on the physical.
I think.
Well, in the application of these passages, but certainly.
Most important would be the mind.
Mm-hmm. Preachers are, even in our own church, certainly in recent.
What percentage of illnesses in our day do you suppose have a mental or spiritual component?
Physical illness is a product of your mental?
A lot of them.
I have heard authoritative people say up to 90%.
Oh. I think, I look back on my own work experience, I think in years.
And you need to tell us that you have been working, you worked as a mental health professional.
Yeah, but I also did some general as well. Mm-hmm. But thinking back in our earlier times in our institutions, there were always people that were on the staff that quietly were witnessing to all of it.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't think we were necessarily being as active in all areas of physical illness and mental illness as we are today. We see it here. We've got active programs. There are departments that never were listed as such in years gone by. Mm-hmm. So I think in that respect, we have made some progress.
Yeah.
So you're talking about this pain that I have with my sacred iliac and my back leg and all of that stuff. That's really due to, I need to work on my spiritual life and it'll fix that up? Or?
Well, what we do know that a lot of pain has components that are not just your hip.
The problem with spiritual and emotional, physical you can measure, test, x-ray, MRI, but the spiritual and the mental you can a little bit, not the spiritual. So you get in a realm where you don't have any guidepost really to hang on to or to guide you.
All of a sudden, in the middle of this discussion of health, James says this. Look at verses 17 and 18. Elijah was the same kind of person as we are, human being. He prayed earnestly that there would be no rain. What was he praying for?
No rain. No rain. Drought.
Yes. Do you think Elijah was praying for a drought?
Well, yes, he was.
Look at a very interesting passage in this context. Look at Deuteronomy 11, 13 to 17. So then, this is Moses' instruction to the children of Israel right on the border of the land of Canaan. They're getting ready to cross the Jordan and go in. So then, obey the commands that I have given you today. Love the Lord your God and serve him with all your heart. If you do, he will send rain on your land when it is needed, in the autumn and the spring, so that there will be corn, wine, and olive oil for you, and grass for your livestock. You will have all the food you want. Do not let yourselves be led away from the Lord to worship and serve other gods. If you do, the Lord will become angry with you. He will hold back the rain, and your ground will become too dry for crops to grow. Then you will soon die there, even though it is good land that he is giving you. Do you think Elijah was praying for this verse to come true?
Was Elijah disgusted with the people around him?
What was going on in Elijah's day?
Ahab and Jezebel.
Jezebel was after it.
Who?
The worship of Baal.
Where did Jezebel come from?
Was it Tyre?
Her father was the king and the high priest of Sidon. The home area for the prophet, for the god, the so-called god, Baal. And she went to Israel with the specific purpose, married Ahab. And her idea was she was going to convert this whole nation to the worship of Baal. That's specifically what she intended to do.
She's a missionary.
Evangelist.
Mm-hmm. For Baal.
I think the king wanted it that way for political reasons.
Well, I mean, if you get the whole country to follow you, then you're in pretty comfortable position, right? Whatever it is.
So is that why we're having the problems up in the San Joaquin Valley? Is there preachers up there preaching that people will come back to God and they'll have a...
I didn't say that.
Well, James said he prayed earnestly for God to bring the drought.
Let's go that, back. Yeah, that's what it says.
It seems like... So now, why would he have to do that?
Last week you asked some questions that I want to sort of follow up with, okay? What did Elijah do? He prayed earnestly that God would fulfill his prophecies. And then God says, okay, over there. And Elijah lived way on the outskirts of society of those days. He lived on the other side of the Jordan River, okay? God says, there's one man over there praying that I will do what I promised I would do. Use that man. And I just, the story of Elijah, I just love this story. He walked across, I don't know where he crossed the Jordan. He walked up to Samaria. He walked up. He didn't ask anybody's permission. He walked into the king's chamber audience room and said, until I say so, there will be no more rain. And he turned around and walked out and everybody goes, and by the time their mouths have closed, they can't find him. He's gone.
Was he like Daniel? Daniel was praying. Daniel knew God's prophecy was praying about the end of the 70 years. Mm-hmm. Us who really know God's prophecy, should we be praying for God's prophecies? As a corporate group, we should be praying for God's prophecies.
Would we dare to predict, would we dare to pray that Jesus come back soon? I wonder why we're called Adventists.
You know, the one thing about Elijah there, where he went up to the king and told him that there will be no rain until I say so. I wonder why he didn't say until the Lord says so. Because that's usually what a prophet does. He speaks for the Lord, but he said, as soon as I say so. Mm-hmm. So I'm wondering, there's some significance there.
I think God intentionally had Elijah say that because it gave the Jezebel and Ahabs of his day a focus.
After him?
To go after him. No, exactly. So they couldn't say, they might have said, well, Baal, the reason there's no rain is because Baal isn't happy with us right now. In fact, I'm sure that's what Jezebel said. Baal isn't happy with us right now. Elijah didn't give them any wiggle room. He said, there will be no rain until I say so.
So they saw God's power through this focus, through this one person. Mm-hmm. And if there's going to be Elijah's at the end, God's power is going to be focused through
those people.
Through those people. So we better be responsible to handle it.
By the way, just to fill up the story, Baal was the god of what?
Rain, storm.
Storm and rain. And lightning, I might add.
Mm-hmm. And when on Mount Hermon, the thunder and the lightning and the clouds mm-hmm. and all that was God.
They'd probably tangled with him before because he'd been associated with the schools of the prophets. They had to have known.
Well, that was afterwards.
Was it?
As far as we can tell, that was afterwards. Yeah,
so still. Jezebel, she had the right idea, just the wrong God. She thought the complications with the rain were because Baal was upset, when in reality it was God was upset.
Think so?
That's what you said.
Then it comes out that it looks like because Elijah's upset, not because of God's upset. So I'm just
Let's take another example. Look at Daniel 9, verses 2 and 3. And he mentions, first of all, he mentions Darius the Mede, who was the son of Xerxes, ruled over the kingdom of Babylonia. And then he says, in the first year of his reign, I was studying the sacred books and thinking about the 70 years that Jerusalem would be in ruins, according to what the Lord had told the prophet Jeremiah. And I prayed earnestly that the Lord God pleading with him, fasting, wearing sackcloth, and sitting in ashes. Can you see a parallel between Elijah and Daniel?
Does it show faith when you actually believe God's prophets and you act?
What do you mean, actually believe God's prophets?
You believe God's prophets and you act on what they say.
Yeah.
Is that the faith God is waiting for?
That sounds like a good place to start, doesn't it? Yeah. Are we picking out specific promises in the Bible and say, God, help me to be the fulfillment of that promise? Elijah did. Daniel did.
Here am I, Lord, send me.
Mm-hmm.
Jonah didn't.
Well, Jonah was a little backwards, wasn't he?
He repented.
If we want to see revival and reformation in the church and then in the world, shouldn't we begin in our own lives?
Yes.
In the great controversy, whose side are we going to be on? Are we living totally? Think about the two sides. God's side is totally unselfish, willing to live for others, willing to serve others. The devil's side is totally selfish. It's all about me, living a self-indulgent life, following the example of Satan. Which side are we on? Now, you don't have to give a personal testimony, but just think about it. Well, let's move on. James 5, 19 and 20. My brothers and sisters, if any of you wander away from the truth and another one brings them back again, remember this, whoever turns a sinner back from his or her wrong way will save that sinner's soul from death and bring about the forgiveness of many sins. That's the end of the book of James. What's he trying to tell us?
Seems to me there's a double meaning there. You're saving somebody, and then by doing it, you may well save yourself.
But let's look at a couple of other verses that are similar. Luke 1, verses 16 and 17. And he will bring back many of the people of Israel to the Lord their God. This is talking about John the Baptist. He will go ahead of the Lord, strong and mighty like the prophet Elijah. He will bring fathers and children together again. Where did we read that before?
Mm-hmm.
Malachi 4, right? and he will turn disobedient people back to the way of thinking of the righteous. He will get the Lord's people ready for him. Okay? Are we doing that?
Every day.
Look at Acts 3, verse 19. Repent then and turn to God so that he will forgive your sins. If you do, times of spiritual strength will come from the Lord, etc. Okay? Do we as a church need to repent? What would happen if we really believed that our highest duty was witnessing for God and finishing the work?
How would a church repent? What would we have? The General Conference President is preaching and he says we need to repent. What would he say we would need to repent over outside of women's ordination? What else would he say?
I don't think we dare list it on TV.
Yeah. Well, I can tell you that there are those who have believed for years and years that we need to repent of what happened in 1888.
And what does that mean?
We don't understand the gospel, according to their version of things.
How do you mean it? We never embraced the message, or we've embraced the message and we've got the wrong message?
We have never fully understood righteousness by faith, if I can quote them.
Mm-hmm. Well, how long does it take to understand that deep and eternal concept?
A long time. So how do we, using the Bible's words, how do we turn our hearts toward God as did Elijah and John the Baptist? Well, let me ask you a challenging question. Christ grabbed attention, there's no question about this, by performing miracles. In Judea, he got himself into trouble really quick by performing miracles. In Galilee, he performed a lot of them. Okay? And people said, come, perform miracles in our town. TV evangelists in our day claim to be performing miracles. We can maybe question whether that's really true. And they get a lot of attention. Some of them become millionaires. If someone on television performs a so-called miracle, does that prove that what they say later is the truth?
Necessarily.
Absolutely not.
No. Not when they find the earphone in his ear.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay. Well, this is a question then. Christ, and I'm quoting now from Ellen White, this is Desire of Ages, page 504, paragraphs 3 and 4. Christ asks us to become one with him for the saving of humanity. Freely ye have received, he says, freely give. What does he mean by that? What does it mean to become one with Christ?
Well, purpose.
Sin is the greatest of all evils, and it is ours to pity and help the sinner. There are many who err and who feel their shame and their folly. They are hungry for words of encouragement. They look upon their mistakes and errors until they are driven almost to desperation. These souls we ought not to neglect. Speak words of faith and courage that will be as a healing balsam to the bruised and wounded one. And I can tell you that I have the privilege, as a physician, of seeing patients every day, quite a number of them. And when I find people who obviously are open to the idea, or seem to be open to the idea, I offer to pray for them. And I have had great, huge guys that you would think are, you know, whatever. You know, in tears, giving me hugs. And lots of women. You know, just so thankful. Now, I don't know, maybe the rest of you don't have that many opportunities.
That is a touch of spiritual love. And their body is so dry for spiritual love.
Yeah.
And they are overwhelmed.
Well, it's a well-known fact that when people are hurting, when they're going through change, where there's some crisis in their lives, they're more willing to listen. They're willing to, if someone seems to have a good idea, go with it. Are we ready to reach out and help and touch lives that are in crisis. What kind of crises could we watch for?
I think.
Or do we sometimes find people in crisis, and maybe sometimes they're crises of their own generation, and we say, stay away from me, I don't want to have anything to do with you. Go ahead, I'm sorry.
Oh, that's okay. I think we're doing it at one level, but we surely can step up the spiritual healing and the emotional healing along with the physical healing.
Well, I'm going to drop back a couple of verses. Look at James 5:16. So then confess your sins to one another and pray for one another so that you will be healed. The prayer, and the King James says the effectual fervent prayer. My Good News Bible says the prayer of a good person has a powerful effect. What does that mean? The prayer of a good person has a powerful effect.
There's probably a force that goes into action that we are not even aware of that then helps that person that we prayed for, and we don't even know that we activated it by our prayer for that person.
I'm going to take just a moment. I once had an experience with a lady who asked me this question. If you were 500 miles away from a friend, in this case it turned out to be her nephew, and they have been had a serious accident and are in a coma, if you pray for them, will it do any good? If you can't answer that question, you don't understand the great controversy. I tried to explain it to her, and after I had spent some time doing that, some weeks later, she came back to me and she said, I have been asking that question to everyone that I thought had any connection with the church at all for 7 years. And you're the first person who gave me a reasonable answer.
That's shocking.
The answer was?
Well, that in the great controversy, the devil is doing his thing and God is doing his thing. And this is the very mini version of it. But God can do some things if we ask him to that he can't do if nobody's asking to.
Kind of like you're untying God's
hands. Yeah. You're untying God's head. You say, God, I'm praying for this person over here. And God can turn to the devil and says, I'm not just doing this because I want to. I'm doing this because these people are praying for me to do it.
That comment you made earlier about most of physical disease, 90% of the physical disease is mentally related. Mm-hmm. And if you can bring truth, healing has to begin in the mind. And like the story of the fellow was lowered down through the roof of the house, he was already pointing in the right direction before he wasn't going there unwillingly.
Mm-hmm. I thought God, we're talking about healing, I thought God healed people because he had compassion on them, not because he was had to wait for somebody to pray for them so that he wouldn't be misunderstood.
Oh, but hold on. Wait. Think about what you're saying. Does God have compassion on everybody?
Yes.
One way or another.
He should. If that was the only criteria, he should heal everybody. Mm-hmm. There shouldn't be a single hospital anywhere.
So then he can't heal unless there's other people praying.
Well,
the devil
I don't
cries foul if he heals that person.
Yeah.
So,
well, I mean,
that sounds kind of like the Mormons baptizing for the dead.
No,
these people need other. I'm uncomfortable that God can't act simply because he wants to act.
Where place?
Now that is a question I've written down here. Is why is it that God seems to play favorites sometimes?
Yeah.
But well, I'm kind of uncomfortable with the idea that, well, he can't play favorites unless he's asked to.
No. Let's be honest now, in light of your question. Do we believe that God could, does he have the power to heal, transform, undo any wrongs, bind up any problems, restore everybody? He could do that if he chose to do it, and he just said, devil, step aside, I'm going to do this. He could do it. And so the question is, why doesn't he? Now the devil comes into the picture.
violating choices.
Mm-hmm. There are.
And you don't think there are some things God can't do?
Was somebody praying for Hezekiah? The only record that we have is Hezekiah prayed.
Yeah.
So there were other people praying.
In his case.
Yes.
Well, we don't know. Maybe they were.
I have fun experimenting, releasing the, asking God for permission. Mm-hmm. Our health club that I go to with the water aerobics and stuff, they opened a spinal cord injury center, a whole big room, and they bring in people who can't walk. And every time I leave the health club and I go by the place and you see the people being wheeled in and a physical therapist, I ask God for a blessing on that room. Let the relationships be healing. Let this club have wonderful results and be an example for other health clubs, because I think it's a good atmosphere for people to be in. And it's just, you know, every time, it's so easy to do every time you go by a place to ask a special blessing on something and then just watch and see what God does as a result of prayer.
One thing about prayer, though, it does let everybody know where you want to go.
Mm-hmm.
And
not
only
silent prayer. Are you talking about public prayer?
No, I'm talking about powers in high places, angels, everybody looking down here, watching the great controversy. If a person prays for a certain direction, it's just made public to them.
You know, there's another couple of reasons that I also like, of why sometimes God seems to answer prayers and he doesn't sometimes. And also in regard to intercessory prayer, where you're praying for others. I think there are some circumstances, and I guess I'm going to think of demon possession or something like that maybe, where somehow people can't pray for themselves.
Mm-hmm.
And
well, even if somebody's in a coma.
Right, yeah. And anyway. And the other thing is that this is an answer that I like maybe at least as much as the one you've given, why God sometimes answers prayers, is that sometimes, and I think I mentioned that here in our in these lessons before, and that is we have a desire and we think we know the solution to that desire and we pray for that.
Mm-hmm.
But God knows that really what we're praying for isn't the solution.
Not the best solution.
That's right. And he knows the better solution, and therefore it appears that he's not answering our prayer when really, really he is. I think I've mentioned in here, I think God says yes to every prayer. It's just sometimes it seems no because we don't seem to realize what we've prayed for.
But okay, now let's focus on that, because the rest of our lesson really talks quite a bit about that. Is James suggesting that we don't need health care at all? We just pray and it takes care of everything? No. Who do we know from New Testament times that was in the medical care business?
Dr. Luke,
one of the gospel writers. He was a Greek physician. So James isn't suggesting that, you know, throw out all regular health care. He's saying pray and do these other things. Maybe, and specifically in this case, he's talking about anointing with oil. What does that represent? Oil represents what in the Bible?
Holy Spirit.
The Holy Spirit. So we're asking, if we do that, we're asking the Holy Spirit to come in and do what he can do in that situation.
It's a physical ritual representing what we're what we're wanting for inside.
Mm-hmm. The word sick in James 5:14 is a translation of the Greek word asthenēo, which means to be diseased, impotent, sick, or made weak. It implies being feeble in some sense. You can read that in Strong's Exhaustive Concordance. So does that mean that any person who is ill in any way should pray for healing and it will come?
When you first read those passages in James, it certainly seems to intimate like that. You get the brethren together and pray and it's going to happen.
Making that kind of assertions for somebody who hasn't thought this through and doesn't understand all that might be going on there, and then you find out, whoop, 3 days later the person dies, and that's going to shake somebody's faith up.
Mm-hmm. Well, what is the Lord's will?
You know? Well, let's talk about that. There's a deeper and more comprehensive answer to that question. God would love to heal everyone completely of all their diseases. I mean, every one of us are His children, right? Not only their physical diseases, but their mental, their spiritual, and their social diseases. Thus, we could say that whenever people pray in faith, God will answer their prayers in the affirmative. The question is not if God will answer the prayers, the question is when He will do it.
Well, going back to your tying of God's hand, there are some rules to the game here.
Mm-hmm.
There are some rules that even God has to play by.
And we know of a number of examples from the Bible when maybe a prophet or maybe Jesus Himself said, be healed or whatever, and they were healed right there on the spot. That happens sometimes. We know some other cases where God says, here, do this and you'll be healed. Naaman had to go and dip in the Jordan River 7 times. The man who had the mud on his eyes had to do what?
Wash.
Go wash in the pool of Siloam. So that wasn't immediate healing. One time Jesus did something and the man says, I see people like trees walking, and Jesus did something more and then he was completely well. So sometimes there's a process. It takes a while before the healing happens. And then there are some cases, and can you think of some examples where God says, no, you're not going to be healed until the second coming?
Paul in his blindness.
Paul with his thorn in the flesh. Many people think it was a partial blindness, maybe following the scales he had on his eyes or whatever. Can you think of any others?
John the Baptist certainly wasn't healed of his beheading.
No. What about Jacob's hip? Remember, he was wrestling with Jesus, we believe, and at the end he just touched his hip, and the rest of his life he had a limp.
But then those things act as maybe reminders that maybe help.
You think there might be some rest of us who need reminders?
I think so. Some of us.
I've got several.
you already have them, huh?
I've already got some, I guess. Not sure I'm making the proper interpretation. But.
What are you supposed to be reminded of?
Yeah, all right.
So is it fair to conclude that some will be healed immediately, others will be healed slowly, but some may not be healed until they're raised from the dead?
And it's not the most important healing a person can have is to a clear understanding of the character of the Creator God.
So contrary to what sometimes has been suggested in the past, if a person doesn't rise from his bed healed right on the spot, it isn't because somebody in the room is lacking faith. It may be because God says, it's better for that person to sleep right now. I have something in mind for him.
But certainly easy to draw that conclusion when you read the first story that you read here of Jesus says, this man has so much faith, why we can heal him.
So James goes on, and if you read the passage very carefully, there are at least 5 steps that James encourages us to go through when praying for divine healing. Let's look at those. 1, we're supposed to call the elders to pray over that person and anoint them with oil. Okay? It should be noticed that the oil, of course, we've already mentioned, is a symbol of the Holy Spirit. Then 2, the word alepho, which the word is for anointing, comes from 2 words, one word meaning unity or a sense of union, and another word that means grease or fat, in this case olive oil specifically, and suggests that God is generously and extravagantly pouring out His Holy Spirit without measure on His children in healing and blessing. God promises to do that, and everybody gets the oil if they're being anointed, even the ones who go on and die. Okay? And then 3, we're to pray with the prayer of faith, and that prayer will save the sick and the Lord will restore them. That's what it says right there. Some people may think that no instantaneous healings and happenings take place in our day, but that's not true. I know of several examples in modern times. I know some people personally who have been involved in situations where people have been raised from the dead, not in this country, but in other parts of the world. So, and we notice that the Greek word agero, which is the word there for being raised, means to waken or to rouse from disease or death, literally or figuratively. It is the same word used in Acts 20, verse 26, verse 8, where it talks about God raising the dead. Clearly, the healing power to remove sickness is the same power that created life in the beginning, right? It can bring the dead back to life again. In this context, we need to realize that the resurrection of the righteous at the end of this world's history will be the greatest healing miracle of all time, right? Yeah. Finally, a couple more points. James admonishes the sick to confess to one another, therefore, your faults. So, this is a time for not only the sick person himself, but those who are involved in the anointing to say, God, if we have some faults, point them out to us. Let's get rid of our faults. Let's move forward in faith. It's the time for building faith. And finally, five, pray also for one another that you may be healed and restored. We need to be healed and restored. We need to pray for each other. We need to move together. Notice especially the word therefore, which is significant. It suggests that there's a causal relationship between the confession of sin and healing. We're not suggesting that every illness is a direct result of some current sin, but rather we're suggesting that all illnesses are ultimately a result of sin. Is it a lack of faith? Now I'm asking the final questions in the last few seconds we have here. Is it a lack of faith to recognize that some will not be healed until the resurrection day? If we had more faith, would we be able to pray over every kind of illness or disease and cause instantaneous healing? I don't think so. We live in a sin-polluted and sin-damaged world. Despite our most fervent efforts and prayers, some are going to die. In fact, all of us are going to die if the second coming is delayed long enough, right? And our children will take our places. So if our prayers are not immediately answered, how can we avoid losing our faith? Are we willing to trust God to make the right decision about healing of individuals? Or are we going to say, God, you have to do this right now? We shouldn't pray like that. No. Like Jesus, we should say, Father, it's your will. Do what you know is best. We trust him that far. Our kind and loving Father, we thank you for this opportunity to do our best to represent your word before others who might be listening. May it go forth the whole world is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thank you.